the greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers. We'll be right back.
mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Authorities arrest the three suspects allegedly involved in the security breach of the Philippine full-bodies tech provider, Smartmatic.
A local research group says a resurgence of COVID cases in the Philippines is possible amid the threat of new Omicron subvariants.
And Russia warns the conflict in Ukraine may escalate into a third world war a day after Washington's top officials visited Kyiv.
The Philippine Supreme Court junks with finality motions for reconsideration on the controversial Anti-Terrorism Act. The High Court said the appeals were dismissed due to lack of substantial issues and arguments raised by the petitioners. In December 2021, members of the Supreme Court voted to void a portion of the law which would have made dissent or protest a crime if it had an intent to cause harm. The High Court ruled that provision tends to violate the principles of freedom of expression. It also voided a section that would have allowed the Anti-Terror Council to designate a person or a group as terrorists based on a request by another country.
Malacañang lauds the Supreme Court's latest decision on the Anti-Terrorism Act. Spokesperson Martin Andanar says the palace considers the ruling a triumph for peace-loving and law-abiding Filipinos. He adds it serves as a stern warning against malevolent elements that the Philippines is not a safe haven for terrorists. But the ruling dismays Attorney Edre Olalia, president of the National Union of People's Lawyers, and a counsel to petitioners. He still hopes that the law will be struck down or amended in good time. In the meantime, he vows to guard and defend against its abuse and misuse.
Facebook has suspended the account of attorney Vic Rodriguez. He's a spokesperson and the chief of staff of presidential candidate Bongbong Marcos. The social media giant says the account did not follow its community standards. In a statement to ABS-CBN, Rodriguez claimed the suspension was due to his support for Marcos, calling it censorship to the highest degree.
Local absentee voting in the Philippines is set to begin on Wednesday. Data from the Commission on Elections showed over 84,000 have signed up for the three-day absentee voting. The LAV is for uniformed personnel and members of the media who will report to work on Election Day. Ballots for the absentee voting will be canvassed on May 9. Poll Commissioner George Garcia seeks to assure voters that their ballots will be secured. He also urges them not to waste the chance to cast their vote for the election.
Huwag niyo pong ibaliwalayin itong pagkakataong ito. Ang pakialam natin is dapat makaboto ang lahat ng Pilipino. Ano man ang katayuan niya sa buhay, lalong-lalo na kung siya ay may trabaho.
In the U.S., poll watchers in Los Angeles expressed disappointment and regret as some accomplished ballots for the Philippine elections are invalidated. Steve Angeles tells us why.
With just 2 weeks to go before the May 9 Philippine presidential elections, the ballot counting for overseas absentee voting resumed on Monday morning at the Los Angeles Philippine Consulate with the feeding of several hundred ballots from a number of precincts. But as the votes began piling up, so did some of the errors. Although no invalid ballots were found during the first feeding last Thursday, at least four of the returned ballots were invalidated due to errors in the ballot, which included voters signing in the wrong place or marking multiple choices in some of the races.
Party list.
For these poll watchers, each of the invalidated ballots is disappointing.
I feel really terrible because, you know, it's, you know, the chance for your voice to be heard. And, you know, the voter must have been very eager to, you know, to make sure their vote is counted. But the voter, yeah. But then apparently, I don't know. It's probably like they didn't understand the instructions in the instruction sheet. And also there's really a need for more voter outreach to teach the registered voters how to vote, how to fill in the ballots.
And while it's also a lost vote, with each ballot taking about a minute from feeding to receive printout, it's also time lost as election officials will also have to do paperwork on each rejected ballot.
The whole process takes 40 seconds from feeding and reading the ballots, and adding all of those mistakes will prolong the whole process. So as much as possible to the voters, please follow the instructions given to you so that, you know, your votes will be counted. Yeah, don't waste your vote.
On the technical side, a handful of paper jams did take place, but were quickly fixed. The mailing of some 35,000 ballots were completed last week, and a few ballots have been sent back to the consulate due to address changes. The consulate is posting a growing list of returned ballots on their website. There are now nearly 500 names on the list, and those who do appear in the list may go to the consulate to pick up their ballots in person.
Consulate will be releasing a series of PSAs in the coming days to not only remind people to turn in their ballots, but also proper ways to fill it out to avoid any mistakes. Steve Angeles, ABS-CBN News, Los Angeles.
Dr. Tricia Robredo, daughter of presidential aspirant and Vice President Lenny Robredo, seeks the help of authorities to go after those behind malicious posts targeting her. ABS-CBN correspondent Nico Bawa now joins us on the line to tell us more. Nico?
The NBI Cybercrime Division received a letter request from the lawyer of Dr. Tricia Robredo, the daughter of Vice President Lenny Robredo. Her lawyer, attorney Pinky Bernabe, is requesting for the NBI to investigate the spread of malicious videos using the name of Robredo. They listed 8 URLs or links of different porn sites and blogs that posted those malicious videos, and they're asking the NBI to to identify the source of these videos and stop the spread of these posts. So far, this is the second complaint that came from the Robredos. The first one, which was also a letter request from their lawyer for the malicious videos using the name of Aika Robredo, the sister of Trisha. This was given 3 days ago. And so far, the NBI has already identified the administrators of these videos, and they'll be sending them letter requests to take down the said videos. The NBI is set to, after the takedown of these videos, the NBI is expected to subpoena the creators or the ones who posted these videos and ask for their side on why they created these posts. They may face charges in violating the Safe Spaces Act and the Anti-Cybercrime Prevention Act. So far, in ICA's case, there's around 60 links or URLs wherein they posted malicious videos. Denise?
Thanks for that report, Nico. Now, a poll watchdog urging the COMELEC to address alleged irregularities and issues regarding overseas voting. Contradaya asserts these include reports of pre-shaded spoiled ballots, faulty vote counting machines, and delayed mailing of ballots to voters.
Itong mga to ay dapat po talagang binabantayan at sana sa COMELEC magkaroon ng malalimang investigasyon at maisapubliko po yung mga resulta ng ganitong klaseng aberya para po maiwasan po ito sa malapit na hinaharap.
Contradaya convener Danilo Arau also calls on the public to help stop the spread of fake news and disinformation. He sounds the alarm over the supposed persistent historical denialism this election season.
Kahit mga ordinaryong tao ay nagsasagawa na rin ng fact-checking, kaya lang hindi pa po ito sapat, I'm sorry to say, kasi kailangan din nating i-expose sa isang banda yung mga nagpapakalat ng pekeng balita. Dapat kino-call out din natin yung mga may-ari ng social media platform.
Initial data from a study conducted by poll watchdog Lente show some local candidates have been using government resources in their campaigns. Joyce Balancho reports.
The election watchdog Lente, or the Legal Network for Truthful Elections, has discovered that there were local candidates who have used government resources during this campaign period. Lente conducted a study to monitor the instances of abuse of state resources, which they consider as a form of political corruption, as incumbent political parties and candidates manipulate or misuse government resources for electoral advantage. Attorney Maris Aldesa from Lente said that the study covered 17 identified vote-rich and income-generating areas nationwide. This study will run for 14 weeks, but initial results of the study showed that less than 30% of the voter respondents and community leaders have observed candidates using state resources and vehicles during this campaign season. However, the study was also able to point out during their focus group discussion that public awareness about such violations is low, hence the possible inaccurate low number of the reported abuses. While some respondents positively identified the misuse of state resources, Lente said these people refused to name the political candidates involved in these activities for the fear of retaliation. Lente hopes COMELEC will be more proactive and will use its motu proprio powers to monitor and investigate such election violations. They also recommend to pass laws that will refine the current legal framework for such abuses, and they hope that this study will be used as basis for any bill to be filed in Congress. While there are already laws prohibiting the use of state resources, such as vehicles, buildings, and others, Lente believes much effort should be done in terms of law enforcement. The group is also calling on the general public to be more vigilant and cooperative in reporting the abuses of state resources. Lente welcomes any report or complaints from the public, and they have posted in their pages their hotlines and contact numbers. Attorney Ona Caritos of Lente said they can provide guidance and legal services to anyone who wishes to file complaints against any candidate found to be violating election laws, specifically misusing state resources during this campaign period.
Authorities arrest three suspects allegedly involved in the security breach of the Philippine pole body stack provider Smartmatic. The suspects, arrested in separate entrapment operations, claim to be hackers who can breach the system of the Commission on Elections. Senator Aimee Marcos had first bared the data leak, but Smartmatic officials insisted the breach did not include any data related to the May 9 polls.
The Cusi wing of ruling party PDP Laban will be joining forces with a unit team of Bongbong Marcos and Sara Duterte. PDP Laban released a poster hinting President Duterte could join their campaign rallies. The president has yet to name his preferred successor, but he has endorsed 17 senatorial candidates, most of whom were from the PDP Laban Cusi wing and the unit team. The PDP Laban Cusi wing has endorsed Marcos for the presidency. They adopted Duterte's daughter as their vice presidential candidate.
Progressive Coalition Makabayan unveils the list of senatorial candidates it will support in the May 9 elections. The candidates include former Ifugao Representative Teddy Bagilat, former Vice President Jejomar Binay, Senator Laila De Lima, Human Rights Defender Attorney Chel Diokno, Sorsogon Governor Chiz Escudero, Attorney Luke Espiritu, Senator Risa Ontiveros, Attorney Alex Lacson, Antique Representative Loren Legarda, and Labor Leader Sonny Matula. The list is on top of two senatorial bets they previously endorsed, Nery Colmenares and Bong Labog. Makabayan President Saturo Campos says these candidates share a common stand with the coalition on various issues.
As we manifested in the declaration, in selecting the senatorial candidates to be endorsed by Makabayan, is we discussed, we presented to them the Makabayan program and specific issues on which they agree. Also, as far as the names that are mentioned, we have been relating with them for a long time on various issues and struggles such as the Marcos dictatorship in the earlier period, then during the Macapagal Arroyo government that we had to work with us because the Arroyo government tried to repress our party system.
Ocampo has this to say about those who criticize their lineup for including candidates who have already been part of the system the group is trying to reform.
Philippine politics is not moving on a straight line, and politicians tend to be pragmatic in certain instances, but there are basic principles, there are basic issues on which the Makabayan has been consistently advocating, with which they concur with us. We are not looking after people who are completely thinking along with us, but who share only certain portions of our advocacies strong enough to consider them as possible allies should they be elected to the Senate.
A faction of Partido Federal ng Pilipinas, which earlier endorsed the presidential bid of Manila Mayor Isko Moreno, has switched its support and is now endorsing Vice President Lenny Robredo. The faction's chairman says they informed Moreno's camp they were evaluating other presidential candidates before eventually backing Robredo's candidacy. The faction earlier said they believe in the leadership of Robredo and her competence and experience to lead the country out of the pandemic. Several volunteer groups, including Ikaw Muna Pilipinas, have also recently shifted their support from Moreno to Robredo as well.
This is a party decision that we had with the Partido Federal Pilipinas endorsing Vice President Lenny for her presidency. This is a party decision, I have said, because of several polls from different sectors, no? Different civil society group and parallel organizations. This is purely voluntary and unconditional.
Philippine Election Commissioner Ray Bulay blames the media after getting criticized over a remark he issued against the critics of the poll body. Bulay told ANC he did not threaten to arrest critics. He reiterates he only issued a warning to those planning to resort to violence should they not get their desired outcome. Several election watchdogs and lawyers groups slammed Bulay's earlier statement, saying it impinged on the public's freedom of expression.
I never said anything wrong.
You said
I'm not taking anything back. It was the spin on my statement that made everything wrong. Mm. And it is done with malice. With malice and with publication, may karuktong yun. Huwag natin sanang putulin yung karuktong. Mm. Kapag nang gulo kayo,
okay,
sa resulta ng eleksyon na ito. Kung ang resulta ng eleksyon ay ginulo dahil doon sa statement na minamind condition mo ang mga tao na kapag natalo, dinaya. At yung mga kakampi na mga yun o mga kaanig, yung word wala akong ibig sabihin doon, yung mga kasagpi ng mga yun, ang tingin nga nila dinaya ng gulo ng eleksyon, ay dadamputin yung mga yon.
Bulay also appealing to the public to have faith in the COMELEC.
Huwag na po nating dagdagan ang problema at pag-isipan pa yung COMELEC na mandadaya. Tulungan niyo po kami na magawa yung mahirap naming trabaho at marami sa pamamagitan ng pagtitiwala. Lahat naman po ay ginawa namin na transparent, at least as far as yung committees that I handle, kasi kanya-kanya po kami dito.
The Philippine Health Department investigates the alleged administration of second COVID booster shots to health workers and the elderly by mistake. Monday's rollout of the fourth vaccine dose was supposed to be limited to immunocompromised individuals. But a hospital in Metro Manila reportedly misinterpreted the guidelines and administered the shots to members of A1 and A2 groups who are not immunocompromised.
Medyo nagkaroon lang ng misappreciation of the FDA, kasi ang FDA inaprubahan yung revision ng indication to include the second booster dose for the A1, 2, and 3. So hindi nila naisip na sa batas, hindi lang yung FDA, may HTAC. So, nagkaroon na ng correction. Meron ng corrective measure na isinagawa at tinitingnan yan ng NBOC ni Yusek Kabutahe. So, yun lang. Inamin naman nila eh. But I think that shouldn't really pose any problems, because at the end of the day, they also need to be boosted the second time around.
Philippine regulators early approved a second booster shot for the immunocompromised, the elderly, and health workers. But the country's Health Technology Assessment Council is still reviewing evidence on the efficacy of a fourth vaccine dose for senior citizens and medical frontliners.
The Okta Research Group echoes calls for a ramped-up COVID booster coverage in the Philippines as it warns of a possible resurgence of infections. Okta fellow Guido David says the Omicron subvariants that are fueling a spike in cases in other countries may also cause another surge here in the Philippines. He says cases may rise by at least 5,000 a day should the new subvariants reach the country.
We're seeing a possible increase in cases. It could happen sometime. Actually, it could happen anytime. Eh. Hindi natin masasabi kung kailan makakapasok yun. Ang dahilan dyan, Yusek, we're seeing an a surge or an increase in cases sa South Africa at sa Delhi, India. Mm-hmm. And these are countries na medyo similar yung characteristics sa Philippines. So mm-hmm. pag nagkakaroon ng increase in cases dyan, lalo na sila, tapos na sila sa Omicron, pero may panibagong sa variant, ang concern natin ay pag nakapasok itong panibagong sa variant dito sa Philippines, magkakaroon na rin ng pagtaas ng cases. As of now, preliminary, we're projecting siguro up to 50 to 100,000 active cases, which means siguro mga 5,000 cases per day, tatas pwedeng po tumaas tayo 5,000 or even 10,000 cases per day.
Philippine health officials look to further raise vaccine awareness as childhood immunization declined significantly in 2021. Now for more on this, we now have Dr. Lulu Bravo, the Executive Director of the Philippine Foundation for Vaccination. Dr. Lulu, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Ron. Thank you for having me here.
Thank you for talking to us. Now, the immunization rate was down to less than half in 2021. That's 48.5%. Of course, there's the pandemic, but was the pandemic the sole factor, the sole reason why the rate has gone down?
Well, you know, worldwide, the pandemic really reduced the routine childhood immunization. Almost 90% of the countries in the world. In fact, we are not only the only country. But, however, we have a certain hesitancy that has been there even before the COVID. Hmm. And that's the reason why we are having difficulty rebounding. Because some of our countries, neighbor countries like Malaysia, Singapore, Indonesia, they have rebounded. They have improved their routine childhood immunization. Whereas in the Philippines, we are still trying our best to improve that childhood immunization to go up high as 90%, which were our batting average before 2018. Did you know that? Mm-hmm. That in the year 2000 to 2015, we had almost 90%, 95% vaccine coverage for our children.
Dr. Lou,
so we do need to work together here.
Right. Remind us why there was hesitancy again.
Well, you know, even before the COVID, we did have the dengue vaccine controversy in 2018 that actually reflected on the way that our children were withdrawn from the health centers. As you know, we did have a very massive measles outbreak in 2019 because our measles vaccination went down. We had our polio outbreak also in 2019, even before the pandemic. So we did have a measles campaign, and I think our Department of Health was very, very responsive in that. And by 2019, we went up, our measles coverage went up. But then 2020 came the COVID, and that was also the kind of disastrous result that we had. And we went down from a good vaccine coverage of 60-80% in 2019 to less than 60% in 2020, and then 2021 yeah. It was about 48.5%. And I do hope we can work together again, media, health workers, pharmacists, even our dentists, aside from, of course, our midwives and, of course, our doctors, are helping and working together and volunteering to get our immunization up and running. And I hope we can do that because this is the only way we will not be threatened by another polio or measles right. outbreak. That is very fatal, you know, measles. Very fatal. If you have, it is a vaccine-preventable disease that we should not have any.
Exactly. Dr. Lu, what kind of scenario are we looking at happening with less children getting immunized? Will we see a jump in the number of kids getting sick with illnesses that could have been prevented, especially this year after the low vaccination rate last year?
Ron, that is really a threat that we are really scared about. Mm-hmm. Because just like in 2019, you remember, whereas we will not having any more measles, we were almost zero measles in 2005. And we were just having one measles would be an equivalent already of an outbreak between 2005 to 2010. And then suddenly in 2019, we had more than 40,000 cases of measles and more than 800 deaths from children. And even adults died in 2019, if you look at our statistics then. And it was only because the Department of Health went on a home, house-to-house campaign, went on giving vaccination to children. And that was the way we were able to boost up our measles vaccination. And also polio. And that was extended from 2019 to 2020. And I assure you that everyone really helped in this campaign. And hopefully this will continue. And if the PMA, the Philippine Medical Association, and all the other civil and medical societies will help us, we can get this up again. This is what we want. And hopefully our other media people will really campaign to make sure that we get vaccinated. This is the week of the World Immunization, and worldwide we are celebrating World Immunization Week this week.
Right.
And hopefully everybody will just really go and get themselves vaccinated if they have not.
And now would be the best time to push for the campaigns, because right now the main challenges would be the restrictions and then the vaccine hesitancy, immunization hesitancy. But the restrictions are starting to get looser, with looser restrictions in the NCR and a lot of other areas here in the country. Are you expecting a boost in those getting immunized again? And what would be the targets? Are we targeting 90% again, going back to the average target that we had before?
Okay, for routine childhood immunization, the non-COVID, please make sure that those who are less than 5 years of age, they need to have a catch-up vaccination. And that will be for measles, for polio, for diphtheria, tetanus, pertussis, even meningitis, JE, Japanese encephalitis, for children 5 years and below, especially the infants. Now, for children 5 to 11, and of course we have 12 years to 18, we do need the COVID vaccine for them, because we still have to reach our targets for them. And as you have said earlier, I was listening to you, we do need to get those vaccines in order to prevent another surge. Mm-hmm. We don't want another surge. And it is only through vaccination of our people, of our target population, that we can control and prevent more of these surges to come in. Because the variants will not be prevented from coming in. The only way that it will not spread is when people get to have herd immunity or get vaccinated. Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. Now tell us what programs and campaigns are the foundation implementing or holding to encourage the parents and their kids to get vaccinated, and for maybe the government to reach its targets.
Ron, the Department of Health has started the Bakunadong Chikiting, while us, we from the Philippine Foundation for Vaccination, and we have been at it since year 2000, when Gavi started to really make awareness of all the vaccines that we need. The PFD is now 22 years old, you know. And we are campaigning to really support vaccination even before. We wanted to let people know the value of vaccine, that if we are just able to get vaccinated, did you know that for every dollar that was spent, that is spent on vaccine, you get a $44 in economic benefit? That is, vaccine is a health investment. And people should realize that. And this is the way that it should be. And when we have campaigns like this, measles, chikiting, ulilit campaigns, we really want the children, because they are the future, isn't it? We want a healthy and happy life for us. The Immunization Week tells us long life for all age group. So maybe it's not just the children. I'm a pediatrician of 45 years, you know, and I have been doing vaccines since 1974 when I finished my medical school. And right now, it's not the children only that should be vaccinated. Even you and me, I'm an elderly, and I have been boosted. I have had my pneumonia vaccine. I have had my influenza vaccine yearly. This is what we need for a long life for all and, of course, quality of life. It's not just longevity. We have to have quality of life. We don't want to be saddled with hospitalization and all those expenses. Why? My goodness. The medical expense for a pneumonia, you should realize once you are intubated, you're going to spend $50,000 to $100,000 daily. And you don't want that, right? So please get vaccinated. COVID, with flu, and also with pneumonia vaccine for the elderly and for the children. Please get your diphtheria, tetanus, polio, measles, meningitis, Japanese B encephalitis, all of them. Even chickenpox, if you don't want to have pockmarks on your face, maybe. And even for adults, you can have your shingles. You know, it's a very painful disease. And that can also happen in adults. Even you and me can be suffering from that. That's why I always get my vaccine.
Dr. Lulu, we are one with you with your campaign and advocacy. Thank you very much for talking to us. Dr. Lulu Bravo, thank you.
Thank you very much, Ron.
Up next, Russia warns a conflict in Ukraine may escalate into a third world war.
And concerns arise over the sale of Twitter to billionaire Elon Musk. More news when we return.
Ng bagay, simula pa lang, siguraduhin Max Protection na. Kasi pag kulang ang protection, baka madaling masira. Sa ngipin, dapat may Max Protection din. Max Alaga ng Unique Toothpaste. With Max Protect Formula. Help stop cavities before they start.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
the greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Welcome back. You're still watching Top Story. A Philippine lawmaker wants a House panel to look into the implementation of the window hours scheme, which resulted in commuter chaos last week. Jackie Manabat now tells us more about this. Jackie?
Ron, party-list group Bayan Muna wants an investigation in the window hours scheme for provincial buses after thousands of passengers were stranded in bus terminals since last week. The MMD earlier set window hours for provincial buses from 10 p.m. to 5 a.m. And citing the new policy, some provincial bus companies released travel advisories saying departures and arrivals from their respective Metro Manila terminals will only take place from 10 p.m. to 5 a.m. But transport regulators have explained bus companies can still fly their routes outside the window hours. However, they can only pick up and drop off passengers from specific integrated terminals and not their own bus terminals. Congress is currently on break and will resume on May 23rd. Bayan Muna Representative Ferdinand Gaite, however, says they are banking on the power of Committee on Transportation to hold meetings and push for an inquiry on the said policy. Gaite adds that the window hour scheme should be suspended temporarily until the government comes up with a solution that will not burden the passengers. The scheme, if continued, might also affect the travel of voters in and out of Metro Manila on election day. For MMDA, the policy states, LTFRB has deployed augmentation or rescue buses for stranded passengers. That's the latest. Back to you, Ron.
Jackie Manabat with that story. Thanks, Jackie.
Russia warns the conflict in Ukraine may escalate into a third world war a day after Washington's top officials visited Kyiv. Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov says Western arms shipments to Ukraine mean the NATO alliance is, in essence, engaged in a war with Russia. Lavrov adds there's a considerable risk of the conflict escalating to nuclear weapons. U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken and Defense Chief Lloyd Austin pledged over $300 million in military funding for Ukraine during their visit and meeting with President Volodymyr Zelensky in a highly secretive trip. Speaking to reporters following that visit, Austin says he is confident Ukraine can win the war against Russia if they have the right equipment.
In terms of their ability to win, the first step in winning is believing that you can win. And so they believe that we can win. We believe that they can win if they have the right equipment, the right support. And we're going to do everything we can, continue to do everything we can, to ensure that gets.
On the ground, Russia's bombardment of Ukraine continues. At least five are reported killed, while over a dozen are wounded after rockets hit Ukraine's central Vinnytsia region. Earlier, Russia's defense ministry also said that missiles destroyed six facilities powering railways that deliver foreign weapons to Ukraine in the eastern Donbas region. President Zelensky said, although it is impossible to predict when the war will end, Ukraine's victory is inevitable.
After weeks of speculations, Tesla boss Elon Musk finally strikes a deal to buy Twitter. The price tag, roughly $44 billion, or around $54 per share. In a statement, Musk said, "Free speech is the bedrock of a functioning democracy, and Twitter is the digital town square where important matters are debated." He added he wants to make Twitter better with new features, including defeating spam bots. Discussions over the deal, which last week appeared uncertain, accelerated over the weekend after Musk wooed Twitter shareholders with financing details of his offer. Twitter would become a private company upon the completion of the deal, which requires shareholder and regulatory approval. Twitter shares closed 5.7% higher on Monday before its trading was halted for the news. It settled at $51.70 per share, which is its highest closing value in 5 months.
Democrats oppose the sale of Twitter to Elon Musk. Democratic Senator Elizabeth Warren says the move is dangerous for the U.S. As she points out, billionaires like Musk play by a different set of rules. Progressive media watchdog Media Matters for America says the deal would be a victory for disinformation and for the people who peddle it. As for the White House, it refuses to comment on the transaction itself, but it maintains President Joe Biden remains concerned about the power that large social media companies hold.
The PSE index gives up Monday's gains and falls back to the 6,900 level as investors weigh comments from Philippine government officials. Rain Muski reports.
Philippine shares and in negative territory on Tuesday. The main index now back below the 7,000 level after shedding 0.6%, while the rest of Asia was mixed. Value turnover remained thin at 4.1 billion pesos and foreign selling continued. First Resources Management and Securities says investors reacted to reports that the amendment of the oil deregulation law will be unlikely during the last 2 months of President Duterte's term. The decline also comes after Philippine Central Bank Governor Benjamin Diokno said the country may consider a rate hike in June. BPI Securities Haj Narvaez acknowledges that while there remains a lot of liquidity in the market and some investors are taking advantage of the volatility, sentiment is cautious.
We always advise investors to take a long-term view. But definitely, I would, you know, my sense is speaking to investors, there's more of a wait-and-see approach. And it's really not being helped by what's happening externally, inflation concerns. And, you know, not just inflation going up, but there's a concern that will inflation eventually impact economic growth, right? Sentiment generally remains more negative than in the past.
Aaron Tsai of First Metro Securities also sees the main index failing to test the 7150 resistance level.
The factors that lead it to stay on the sidelines and even cash in part of their portfolio outweigh the good earnings that we have so far.
Meanwhile, Emperador finished almost 2% higher before settling back at 19 pesos and 20 centavos per share after reporting its 2021 profit grew 35% to 10.8 billion pesos. The largest global brandy company attributed the gains to sales growth due to higher margins. But Union Bank shares dropped 4.5% after the company reported a net income that's 45% lower year on year. UBP cited extraordinary trading gains in the first quarter of 2021. Rain Musngi, ABS-CBN News.
De La Salle University center Michelle Cobb has announced she will no longer be playing in the upcoming Season 84 Women's Volleyball Tournament. What's next for the two-time UAAP champion? Michelle Cobb now joins us live for More on That. Hi, Michelle. Thanks for joining us.
Hi, Denise. Thank you for having me.
Now, it's, I think, 2 weeks or maybe almost 3 weeks before the UAAP volleyball season will be starting. And then you dropped the news last night that you will be retiring from the UAAP. Lots of fans were quite sad, to say the very least, with your news. But, you know, what brought about that decision?
Actually, I mean, to be completely transparent, it was really something that I've foreseen ever since before. Mm-hmm. I think, syempre, we all know really what happened the past 2 years, and it was a long time. To be honest, the 2 years that, you know, everything was, you know, not working, syempre, walang UAAP, ganyan. And, yeah, I guess it's just the times in itself. And, yeah.
The last time, you know, we talked and interviewed you, first it was just, you know, foregoing the PVL, you know, if you didn't join the F2 team. But UAAP always feels, I guess, so much bigger than that because you are quite a star for the De La Salle team. I guess, what brought about, aside from, of course, the times and the, you know, the 2 years that COVID has brought on your volleyball career, was it, did you lose, I guess, the love for volleyball, or you decided to pursue other passions?
I think not necessarily other passions. It was more of, I found a lot of, like, I guess, more openings in that 2 year gap. Syempre, parang, I had a lot of time to think, and it was really a long time. Like, 2 years, really a long time. But overall, I think also data part is because I also just graduated, mm-hmm. both my graduate and postgraduate studies. So, yeah.
Now, what does this spell, I guess, for the De La Salle volleyball team? You provide stability, you know, with your seniorship, your leadership, and also, of course, you are the setter. So, what is to be expected, I guess, of the De La Salle volleyball team without Michelle Cobb?
Well, I think this has been happening for decades now, that someone leaves and someone takes this someone's place. So this is not new rin for the team. And also I have experienced that, you know, filling in for someone who has already left. So again, it's not new. And I feel like we should still, you know, believe, because I do believe that this year's team is definitely a team to look out for. And syempre, andun pa rin naman kami to support them and the girls. I'm very excited for all of them. So, yeah.
Now, looking back in your UAAP career, two-time UAAP champion, I'm sure there are a lot of things off the court with your teammates that you treasure and you would be missing. But when it comes to on-the-court games, I guess, also rivals that you've experienced and you've faced, which is, I guess, the most memorable for you?
Memorable. There's a lot of memorable memories. the championships that we won, season 79, season 80, of course, memorable. Of course, I think the little things would be like my first ever service in the UAAP was a service ace. So that was really memorable. And also, I guess, syempre, memorable for me is playing my first and last game of season 82. That was really a memorable game, and also the only game I will be looking back at now, you know, the most recent. But yeah.
And now, officially, we will be saying Michelle Cobb, former DLSU Lady Spiker. Thank you, Michelle, for joining us.
Thank you.
Now in the NBA, the Boston Celtics are the first team to reach the second round of the playoffs. That's after they completed a series sweep of erstwhile title favorite, the Brooklyn Nets. The Celtics edged the Nets in the series clinching game 4, 116 to 112. Jason Tatum led Boston with 29 points. Kevin Durant had a game-high 39 points for the Nets, who will now head into the offseason with questions on how their superstar-laden team could not contend for the championship.
Young NBA superstar Ja Morant is known for being a great teammate, but he took that reputation a notch higher with a surprise gift that left his Memphis Grizzlies backcourt partner in shock. See, Morant has been named this season's most improved player. He did that by averaging over 27 points, 5 rebounds, and nearly 7 assists per game. But Morant felt teammate Desmond Bane was more deserving of the honor. So he sent the trophy to Bane, who wasn't a finalist for the award, despite doubling his scoring average from his rookie season. And those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Tinsai.
And I'm Ron Crows. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thank you for watching.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.